Well, good afternoon and welcome and happy Father's Day to all the fathers out there from the Yarra Valley Writers Festival. It's the second of our new release Sundays, and today we have a real treat for you in talking to beloved actor, raconteur, writer and autobiography writer, in fact, John Wood, famous for his roles in Rafferty's Rules, Blue Heelers, etc., etc. How I clawed my way to the middle. I'll be talking to John in just a sec, though. First of all, the Yarra Valley Writers Festival respectfully acknowledges the traditional owners, the Wurundjeri people, as the custodians of this land. We pay respects to all Aboriginal community elders, past and present, who have resided in the area and have been an integral part of the history of the region. John Wood, who I've known and worked with, in fact, over several years now, as I said, also a bit of a neighbour here up in the Yarra Valley, has put out his autobiography at long, long last with the delicious title, How I Clawed My Way to the Middle. John Wood, hello and a happy Father's Day.
Hi, Michael. How are you?
Thank you. I'm great. It's nice to see you in this strange, vicarious world in which we've become so accustomed to over the past 6 months. 2020 will be really one of those years to remember, not in all the right ways either. And before we get to the book, John, it must be a kind of peculiar experience having spent so much time writing the book, and then suddenly we're in this big kind of global hiatus where normally you'd be touring around the place, doing writers' festivals and being taken up to Sydney and Brisbane and speaking to people. But here you are stuck at home with me looking into a computer screen.
Yeah, it's very weird. One of the things I was really looking forward to was I've only ever been to one other book launch, and I was really hoping to get to one of my own, but it's not going to happen, I don't think. We might be able to get out to some country towns next year, but it's all been done online, which is very weird.
We'll be talking about this year for a long, long time. How I Clawed My Way to the Middle. It's such a delicious, I mean, it's a funny title
level. It was meant to be.
Yes, good. Well, it certainly works. But there's kind of a truth in it too, because as you point out, talking about your life and your extensive career on stage and in television, in Australia, there really only is the middle, isn't there? We don't
I think you're right. Yeah, I think to have gotten, like if I'd clawed my way to the top, I would have had to climb over several other bodies and climb a few more rungs and have gone to Hollywood or the UK, and neither appealed. You know, when the opportunity was there to go to the UK back when I was in my early 20s, I felt very strongly that if I had anything to say, it was to an Australian audience, the audience that lives just down the road there in Croydon, where I grew up. They were the people that I, if I had any sort of a voice, that was the voice that I needed to use. And I was very lucky to come into the industry at the same time as people like Jack Hibbard and David Williamson, John Romerill, Alex Buzo. And it suddenly became okay to have an Australian accent. Prior to my generation, though, everybody had to have a vaguely mid-Atlantic accent. The ABC was notorious for it. It was, the mid-Atlantic accent, partially English and partially American. And all the news readers and presenters on the ABC had those mellifluous voices and spoke with a slight accent. And, it was... I just didn't think
the old days of 3AR and 3LO, they always had those sort of voices, didn't they?
That's right, yes. But I never regretted not going until recently. I was thinking about it sometime in the last 10 years, and it just suddenly occurred to me that I was doing all these shows in Australia that Albert Finney had done in London. you know, and I was the go-to person to play the Albert Finney role. And I thought, gee, maybe I should have gone overseas to see how I'd go against people like Albert Finney, because, you know, they were, I mean, he was slightly ahead of my generation, but not much. And, you know, like, and the people that I really loved as actors were people like Finney and Tom Courtney, Alan Bates, Vanessa Redgrave. You know, they're all slightly older than me, but they were basically my generation of performers. And delighted to, you know, she wasn't very famous at the time, but I met Judy Dench in about 1972 when she was out here touring with A Midsummer Night's Dream, a Peter Brook version of A Midsummer Night's Dream. And I sort of had an intro to her because I'd met her brother, Jeffrey, in Sydney when I was doing Death of a Salesman, which was my first professional show. And he'd come to see that, and we'd gotten on very well at the after party. And he said, oh, my sister's in the cast too. You should say hello to her. And I met her, and she was fantastic. But, you know, like, she's, I don't know, she's a few years older than me too. But, you know, I look at the way the English theatre treats her, you know, the respect that they have for her. And, I mean, I'm not saying that the Australian theatre doesn't respect me, but the English theatre scene, the English and television treat their older actors with, you know, they're sort
such
of
reverence.
You know, they're part of the community still, and they're valued. Whereas in Australia, you know, you get over 50 and nobody gives a rat's.
So. Well, not you, old son, not you, old son. And we'll get to the latter part of your career later. But I do want to go back to the beginning. You speak so well of that pre-modern Australia, John, in the book. There's one description you have of being as a kid in the car. I think you'd been down to Flinders or something, as staying at a friend's rather nicely fitted out holiday home down, and coming back as a kid, you just noted the eternal greyness of the Australian suburbs. And I can see this image is of a little boy looking out the car window. And is that what it was like? Did it seem grey before the kind of marvellous Melbourne, marvellous Australia take for granted?
It did, today? You know, like prior to the Beatles, you know, Australia was very...
You went to see.
Yes, I did, you know, but I went to see them not because I wasn't a big fan. I mean, I was a fan, but not a massive fan. I remember I went with a friend of mine to Stoney's in Ringwood. Stoney's was an electrical store and they sold records. And I was with a mate of mine from school, Michael Walters, and we had enough money to buy one album each. You know, I think they were $2.99 or £2, right. nineteen shilling, whatever. Anyway, it was. And I bought a record of a band called the Temperance Seven because I'd seen them at the Croydon Drive-In on a show called Trad and All That Jazz, and I thought they were fantastic. And up until then, I'd been a big trad jazz fan. I'd, you know, I'd gone to Gasworks at Kew and Black and Blue, and you know, all those sorts of places. And so I bought this trad jazz record, and Michael bought an album called Please Please Me by the Beatles. I think he made the better choice. But I found out many, many years later, in fact, only quite recently, that the lead singer in the Temperance Seven was Ronnie Wood's big brother.
And, yes.
Nice.
Your father had, you didn't come, it's an understatement to say that you didn't come from any kind of theatrical background, although later it was revealed that your dad, who I want to talk about a little bit, confessed to some theatrical ambitions, but much too late and much later in life. He was the generation that fought the Second World War and was taken prisoner in Greece or Crete. Is that correct?
In Greece, yes. They were taken prisoner at Corinth, and they'd been overrun in Athens, and so they headed south into Piraeus, and they couldn't get on a boat. It was, you know, they got onto a ship at Piraeus Harbour, and that was dive bombed by Stukas and sunk at the wharf. And so they got off that and kept going south, and they were eventually taken prisoner at Corinth. And I was in Corinth, you know, when I did Who Do You Think You Are? I was taken to Corinth, and you know, it's an amazing place. It's really extraordinary. And I don't know whereabouts they were exactly taken prisoner, but it was, you know, there were old Roman ruins there, and the palace of Corinth was on the coast, and it was up this incredibly steep hill, you know, like it would have taken me a day to walk up it. It was so steep, but that's where Dad and his mates were taken prisoner on an olive plantation or an olive grove, and somebody, you know, they thought they'd be okay, and they thought they would be able to still head south and get to Crete and then get away, but they were in this olive grove, and a Messerschmitt was flying over dropping hand grenades into the olive grove trying to flush them out, which they succeeded in doing. I mean, I wouldn't want to be hanging around while somebody's dropping hand grenades on us. But
did he talk about the war much, John? How forthcoming was he about it? Because he was then a prisoner of war for several years and was
working. Yes, he was. He didn't talk about it much at all. There was where we lived in Croydon, right next to our front yard, there was a big shed, you know, which was a factory that made water tanks, and that was owned by Freddie Taylor and his son Johnny, and they handmade water tanks every day of the week, and it was that was eventually taken over by some new neighbours, and his name was Millwood and Mill Ward, and Dad came in to get us one night. We were playing in the factory, and with Tony, who was our next door neighbour's son, and Dad came in, and it was the first time that the two fathers had actually met each other, and it turned out that Doug Millwood had been in a Japanese prison camp, and that was the first time I ever heard Dad talk about his experiences at all. And they just swapped war stories and prison camp stories, and they talked for a couple of hours, and we were there, my brother and myself and Tony, and just watching, we're absolutely awestruck as we listened to these stories about their wartime experiences.
It's funny now, but because you would think that would be an entree for him to open up more about it, or to be asked by his family, like, oh, tell us more about what you did. But that generation, it just wasn't like that, was it? They didn't talk about those.
No, things. It wasn't. And they certainly didn't, you know, like it's a bit like the way I feel about being a celebrated actor. You know, I don't feel that I've done anything that special. And Dad and his mates all just, you know, they all enlisted and they all went, and some of them had adventures and some of them just, you know, slogged along. He was, he was known as Logger Wood, Logger the Slogger, they called him, and Logger the Foot Slogger. And they just, he claimed never to have pointed his gun at anyone, you know, in the entire war. And apparently that's quite common. You know, I think most people would balk at having a human being in their sights and shooting at it. I balk at shooting at anything. I have no desire to kill anything at all. But
you grew up in Croydon, and there's a wonderful symmetry with your most beloved character, Tom Croydon, who we'll get to later. Your father worked, and I also love the symmetry, the fact that your father took a job at an abattoir on the other side of town over in Footscray. Just, I can't imagine what the commute was like back in those days. Horrendous. It was the abattoir that... Oh, I beg your pardon?
It was horrendous. The cars that Dad and his mates had were just old bangers, you know, and to drive all the way from Croydon to Footscray every day. I mean, and the traffic wasn't terrible, but, you know, these cars were just about falling to bits, and they would drive all the way to Footscray and all the way back every day. And it was, never planned. He took the job at Footscray when he and Mum lived at Port Melbourne in Mum's parents' house. And the plan was that they were going to live in Altona. They'd bought a block of land at Altona next to my mother's brother, Ken, and they were all going to live at Altona together. But Dad decided that he wanted to get back to the country, and because he was from Swan Hill. And Croydon
was the country then, wasn't it?
It really was.
Yeah,
yes, yeah. It was more the country than where I am now at Wandon. It was much more countrified than this. And
there's a wonderful moment in the book you talk about, because after a few jobs and some great characters, you describe the characters you meet, the job you had with the railways for a while, and then working out of the Newport Railway yards. And those old Australian characters of old, those old working class, eccentric working class Australian characters who seem to have kind of gone now, you capture really well. Then you went to work in the very same abattoir with your father. And there's a wonderful moment where you describe moving a load of severed sheep's heads. It's quite bizarre and gothic. Yes. And seeing some writing on the wall. Yeah. And it's your father's name, written when he first started in 1946. And there up the line is that very same man, your father.
Yes. And, you know, like the thing I always, you know, like it was the most natural thing in the world that Dad worked at the abattoir, you know, like he'd grown up, as I said, in Swan Hill, and he did a lot of work with sheep and, you know, he's a farm labourer. And it seemed to us that, you know, that was just the natural way of the world. Dad got up at 5 o'clock and went to Footscray to work in the abattoir, and he got home at 6 o'clock. And if you were lucky, you'd have the strength to kick a football. But, you know, most nights he didn't. And he also, you know, because of his wartime experiences, had terrible stomach ulcers, which, you know, I understand can now be cured with an antibacterial vaccine. But he put up with those all his life, that pain. And, but it just seemed like the most natural thing in the world. And it wasn't until I'd moved those pig's heads and saw the, you know, and the letters were huge. They were, you know, they were 4 or 5 feet high, big black letters, you know, written in, you know, like, and they were obviously written by somebody who didn't expect to be there when, you know, certainly didn't expect to still be there when I came along and found his name on the wall, you know.
How many years later were we talking?
Fuck you, I'm going, I'll be gone, you know, and he never went.
But it was 20 or so years later, wasn't it, John? Your mum sounds an interesting character too. A very well-read woman, a working-class woman again, but because you're one of four, is it? You're the second eldest, John, is that correct?
No, I'm the eldest. The eldest of four,
wasn't it?
No, a younger brother and two younger sisters, all born 2 years apart. Your mother was
very well read. I'm sorry, go on.
Yeah, well, I don't know whether, you know, like I guess there'd be a difference between being well-read and being a voracious reader. I think well-read sort of infers that there is some sort of retention of ideas or something from the books. But you know, she was a voracious reader. But she read the Sun every morning and quoted that back at you. And Dad, you know, like Dad read The Age. I don't know, you know, like. And everybody else at the abattoir read The Sun, you know, except for Dad. He was the only one who read The Age, and then he would bring it home, and Mum would read that to see where it differed in from the Sun. And I think she'd probably be outraged by the difference these days. You know, like I've never, you know, like I read those Murdoch papers, and I just think, my God, you know, what planet are they from? Does, you know, there's no relation to the world I witness, you know, it's extraordinary.
But neither your parents, because many actors from similar backgrounds often have great trouble getting acceptance from parents and family of what they wanted to do. You wanted to act and only act, according to your book, from a very early age. And your parents accepted that. They said, oh, well, if I'm reading it correctly, there was no great resistance. There was a comment by your father, why do you want to do that sissy kind of work? But you weren't actively trying to be talked out of it, were you?
No, not really. I mean, and they had, you know, they, like everybody else, had absolutely no idea of what being an actor involved. You know, the only person that they had any knowledge of who lived as an actor was Frank Thring. You know, it never occurred to them that they never thought of Graham Kennedy as an actor. Mum thought of him as the boy next door that she was, you know, she deeply loved. And Noel Ferrier would never have been considered an actor. Not, you know, like I used to watch the Noel Ferrier version of In Melbourne Tonight, and I used to love it because it was so theatrical. You know, like Freddie Parslow and Frank Thring and Mary Hardy would, you know, where Graham on IMT would do all those little blackout sketches with Joff Allen and Rosie Sturgis and things like that, which I must say I loved. But, you know, like when Noel did his Thursday night show, I think it was Thursday night, he'd have Frank on doing little vignettes of a blind man being threatened with murder, you know, like, and it was just, I just loved it, you know, I really loved it. I thought they were, and it never occurred to me, of course, that I would end up meeting and working with all those people, you know, like it never entered my head that I would ever even meet them, let alone work with them. And but as I say, they it wouldn't have occurred to them that Noel was an actor. They thought of him as more of a radio announcer, as they did with Graham. And Frank was the actor, and Frank was obviously homo. And so all actors were homosexuals as far as they and everybody else were concerned. So,
of course, everyone knows that. What was your first step towards that world, John? Was it the Melbourne Youth Theatre?
That was the first serious step, I think, was basically, but I basically did it at school, you know, like I just got this love for it, for not so much performance. Performance was okay, but you know, like I directed a play with 11 other kids in the classroom, and John Ellis, who was another English teacher in the school and the person that we all admired because he was only 10 years older than us. We were 14 and he was 24 and he had a rocker haircut and wore suede jackets and stuff like that. And we thought he was the ants pants. And
one of those new generation of hip teachers that the kids went, wow, I remember a couple of those, like exactly a young guy who had far more in common with you than the older,
most of the other teachers were either returned servicemen who'd done a course when they got back and became teachers, or were, you know, it was Ringwood Tech was a trade school, or they were tradesmen who'd become teachers, you know. The odd art teacher and the English teacher, but the English teacher also, I don't think he was a tail gunner, but he might have been a co-pilot or a navigator in Lancasters, but he was the English teacher, and he'd come back and done that course and become a teacher, and he was a terrific bloke. And but John Ellis was, you know, like he had worked as an amateur actor, and he was, strangely enough, he took me down to see something that he was doing at the Arrow Theatre in Middle Park, which funnily enough was owned by Frank Thring. And I went to see him in this play called Arms and the Man. You know, it was constantly referred to as the Chocolate Soldier in those days, but it was Arms and the Man, and he was in that. And the only other person I remember from the show was a guy named Leon Lissick, who went to the UK and became quite well known and came back to Australia only in the 1970s to do a role in Power That Glory. Way workshops when John came back from the UK, he and Lois Smith went overseas, as people all did except me in those days, and they came back and they formed Melbourne Youth Theatre, which was, you know, John had done a lot of his work at Ringwood Tech and various schools, and they both came back and they were working at the teachers' colleges at Rusden and at Parkville and Melbourne Uni and Monash. And Lois and Ron and Max Gillies were at Parkville and John was at Rusden, and they formed this group, Melbourne Youth Theatre, which was open to people up to the age of 26. And I was still only about 18, I think, at the time, but... I don't know even how John would have got my number, you know, like that he met me at the Newport Railway canteen.
I know talk about the surprise you feel when you picked up the phone. Did you see yourself then as primarily a stage actor, or did you have ambitions to do what you ended up doing, spending a lot of your career in television?
I had no intention of being on television. It didn't occur to me that I ever would.
Did you watch much television?
As you say, I've spent half my career on television. You know, I've spent as much time on TV as I have on the stage, I think. And
were you a fan of television? Did you watch much of it?
Not a lot. I mean, you know, I remember... I mean, the first thing I ever saw on telly, I think, was Zorro in black and white on an old rosewood television of my schoolmate Patrick's. And Patrick was, they got a telly very early on, and I used to go around and watch Zorro, and the Mickey Mouse Club, of course, was the big favourite. And like everybody else my age, was madly in love with Annette Funicello. And... Yeah, so, you know, but that was about the strength of it. I didn't watch stuff like Homicide much. I do remember Homicide being around, but there was another show called Consider Verdict.
Yes, and things like Divorce Court and things like that. I think my mother had a few roles in Divorce Court and things like that.
Oh, really? Yeah, I don't know, but yeah.
All filmed at the old Channel 7 telly theatre in Johnson Street, Fitzroy.
Oh, right, yes. The only time I ever went there was to see Max Phipps in the Rocky Horror Show.
That's where it started. The big turning point, of course, John, came when you got into NIDA, the very coveted and very hard to get into National Institute of Dramatic Art, when it's still very coveted and hard to get into. Whether it has the same cachet these days, I'm not so sure. But you were quite surprised yourself when you got in.
Yes, I was absolutely... Well, I think gobsmacked is probably the word. It was... because, you know, I had to fill in a form that Lois Ellis got for me, because she had been to NIDA. She'd been in the... I thought she'd been in the first intake, but maybe she was slightly later. But she was in the same year as Robin Nevin and Don Phipps and Peter Couchman. I only remember them because Lois was there, but... I got the form, and, you know, of course, the first thing you see on the form is the you can only get in if you've got your leaving certificate, which I didn't have. And I thought, there's not much point even auditioning, you know. And in fact, I've always felt there's not much point auditioning. I'm not very good at auditioning. And anyway, I auditioned and got in, and you know, like, I actually even got a scholarship, $6 a fortnight, which doesn't sound like much now, and it wasn't
it
much.
It doesn't.
Anyway,
what year are we talking? Just so we know where we are in the timeline.
Well,
what
I had my going away party at John and Lois's place in Canterbury on the day that Harold Holt drowned. So it was a bit of a mocker on the party. And I'd taken along my special new album, the Rolling Stones, their Satanic Majesties album. And but the thing that most people, of course, remembered about the day was that Holt had disappeared. And but that was my going away party. And then I turned 21 that year, I think. Yeah, it must have been 67. Yeah, I turned 21 in July of that year. And so it had been a big year for parties. I had a 21st birthday party at Leslie's house in Ringwood East. And then, you know, we had the going away party. And then I loaded everything I owned into my old MGTF. Everything I owned, all my clothes, any books that I still had that I hadn't given away, a few records and a record player, and piled them all, and a guitar, which I remember was sitting over the top of my head as I drove to Sydney, and headed off to Sydney at the end of 67 and began in 68. So I was there 68, 69. And my first year as a professional was 1970. So it was all...
Well, a very exciting time I was a small child at that time, but there was a lot happening in Australia then. I mean, there was Vietnam, there was the whole 60s, there was the whole breaking away from the old world, and you were in the arts. Did you feel like you were on the kind of a new wave of something, whatever it was?
I didn't actually. No, I mean, again, you know, like it sort of all happened around me. You know, I didn't. The year before, I'd had a letter from the government saying that I hadn't been, my number hadn't been called out, and
that would have been a relief.
Conscripted, but and if I had been conscripted, I probably just would have gone along like a sheep. And, you know, it was the period, you know, there was a lot of anti-Vietnam War sentiment, of course. Mm. And, of course, I was against it as well. I was very much against our involvement there and thought we were wrong to be there. And, you know, but the thought of getting conscripted filled me with horror. But I also felt... you know, like that it was just the natural progression of things. You know, Dad had been in the Second World War and my grandfathers had been in the First World War and I was going to be in the Third World War. You know, that was my turn.
Yeah.
And I would have hated it. I still can't bear the thought of, you know, pointing a gun at someone and shooting them. It's just not a, you know, and the way we're going with China at the moment, we're going to have to shoot an awful lot of people.
Yes.
There's a lot of them. That's
heaven forbid that we get there. You not only got into NIDA, you survived the very, very infamous cutting after the first year. And there's a wonderful story that you tell. You think it was because of your, just being modest, your big mellifluous voice. And some of the characters that you were, some of the quite confusing. I was following the characters, the people that you met, they're all real kind of characters of the 60s and 70s. Joe McCollum and Jack McCallum. I could never quite tell the difference between who was who. But there's a cavalcade of people that you meet and introduce to us through the book. It must have felt like a bit of a whirl being young and being there and being on the verge of embarking on the career that you'd wanted to since a child.
Yes, it was a funny place, NIDA, back then. It was, I don't know how professional it was, and I don't know how professional the industry was, really, at the time. And, but it was, I've always believed, and I still believe very strongly, that you cannot teach people to act. You know, if they can't do it, they just can't do it. You know, it's not a, but, you know, for me, it was just something I could do. You know, it came naturally to me. I could read and understand scripts, whereas most people look at a script and that it makes no sense to them. You know, they read books, they read novels, they read textbooks, but they try to read a play and they just get tied up in the, you know, the name and then the speech and then the stage directions and the, you know, and again, you know, I had not a lot of trouble understanding Shakespeare either, you know, like it just seemed to wash over me. And, I'm not claiming any sort of genius with Shakespeare. It seems to make sense. I comprehend it most of the time. I mean, there are obviously phrases and things that I don't understand and have to work on to get, but I find the easiest way to understand Shakespeare is to read it out loud.
You know, as it was meant to be. In fact, you actually talk about one of your earlier, going back a bit, one of your teachers who gave these dreadful renditions and wouldn't let any of Macbeth reading it out in class, and gave these dreadful dry renditions, sort of sucking every ounce of life and humour out of it. But a lot of us were taught that way, I suppose. I just want to read some of your own words back to you on acting, John, on the chapter that you actually describe as on acting. You begin with, "I honestly don't know what possessed me to create this heading. I don't have the faintest idea about the subject, acting this is. I don't understand the processes well enough to teach it, and often, in fact, think it can't be taught. You can either do it or you can't. I've resisted many requests to teach. While you're in the midst of working, you can see where things are going wrong or where, perhaps, a friendly piece of advice might help, but I wouldn't call that teaching. Sometimes the best thing an actor can do for a particular performance is to learn to shut up a little bit." I love that.
Well, I think it's true as well, yeah. But
and as you went into your professional career, I mean, you talk about the different styles of acting that you come across, in particular, when you started doing telly, and this goes back to perhaps the lack of ambition that a lot of Australian actors had when you work with some English actors and American actors. And it's so funny. And you talk about a technique that people overseas acting had developed, winning the scene, which I'd never heard of. Can you explain how that works?
Well, oh, look, I don't really. The only experience I really had of it was we were working with a very well-known English actor, Lorraine Bailey, and I. And Lorraine is very, she's very down to earth as well. And
you were always a one-take wonder, weren't you?
Sorry?
You were always a one-take wonder, and so was Lorraine.
Well, I wasn't always a one-take wonder, but, you know, I found it much easier to get, you know, to build yourself up to the take and then do it and not have to do it again. You know, like it's quite difficult to get yourself into the position where you do it. And if it goes wrong, to have to do it again is a crashing bore, really. But we were doing a scene and it was on The Challenge, and I was playing Alan Bond and she was playing Eileen, and we, you know, it was a fairly simple scene. There wasn't that much in the way of dialogue, but the actor had to pour us a glass of brandy, and then every time he poured, he'd go, oh, and he just wouldn't get, he couldn't get it right. We'd done everything on the first take. We were right. So as far as we were concerned, it was finished. But it took us 9 more takes before we actually got the brandies right. And it's just such a waste of time, you know. But I bet you, you know, winning the scene is that when we finally did the take, Lorraine and I were so over it that our performances are probably shithouse, and he was right on song. And, you know, so that's winning the scene, you know.
There like you go.
He won the scene. The only person anybody would remember from it is him.
That's right. That's and also... the very brief encounter you had with the American actor Robert Vaughan when you were playing Sir Robert Menzies in The Last Bastion, wasn't it? Tell us that story. It's terrific.
Well, it was really interesting because I had no... I mean, I'd not really worked with big overseas stars. And I'd been a big fan of him in The Man from U.N.C.L.E. I thought he was a fantastic actor. And of course, I saw him in a couple of other things, but he was brought over to meet me. I was on the set talking to Michael Blakemore and Nancy Hayes. And I'd just arrived on location from Melbourne. We were somewhere in the Blue Mountains, I think, and we were in this little house set that was supposedly the Curtin household. And I'm not sure how... It was the first time I'd met Michael Blakemore, but I think I'd known Nancy from previous encounters. She's a wonderful woman, fantastic actor, and a really terrific, terrific person. Well, you know, one of the highlights of the industry, in my opinion. But we were just chatting, and Robert Vaughan came on. You know, my view it was that MacArthur was a much bigger man, you know, than Robert Vaughan. But anyway, I wasn't in costume or anything. I'd just arrived and was just wearing my street clothes. And I think he was in his American Army uniform, and they dragged him into this room and said, Mr. Vaughan, this is John Wood. He'll be playing Menzies. And he took my hand and he took it for an exceptionally long time. And he just looked at me and, Menzies. Gave me back my hand, and
that was it. Menzies.
But he remembered who I was playing.
The big, well, skip over couple of the earlier roles. I actually do remember one of your earliest the earliest TV roles, which is on Barrier Reef, a show I did love as a young person. And I think there was a sequel, The Rovers. Were you in The Rovers? Do you remember that one?
No.
That was Rowena Wallace, I think, did it after The Rovers. But anyway, the big break, of course, came for you. Well, no, not a big break. You were an established actor by this stage, John, was Rafferty's Rules, where you played
That was in the mid 80s. It was after I'd stopped working as an actor for a while and worked mainly as a writer. I'd written for Cop Shop and Prisoner and the Sullivans, and I eventually got asked to go to Adelaide to do a show called Lulu with Judy Davis, directed by Jim Sharman. And I went, and then we formed a company called the Lighthouse Company. Mm. Jim and Neil Armfield and Louis Naara were basically the heads of, and we were there for 2 years working as an ensemble company, a great, great company of actors. It was, apart from me, there was Jeffrey Rush, Kerry Walker, Russell Kiefel, Robin Bourne, Robert Menzies. It was, Gillian Jones. It was a great company. There were 12 of us, and we were in every show, and we played either we had a leading role, or we played supernumeraries, and we were in everything together, and it was a wonderful company. And I probably did the best acting of my career in that 2 year period. I played Bottom in Midsummer Night's Dream, which is an absolute delight of a role, and Jim did a wonderful production of the play, and it was sensational, and everybody in the cast was wonderful. Jeffrey as Oberon and Gillian Jones as Titania, and Robert Menzies and Jackie Phillips and Robin Bourne as the lovers, and it was wonderful. And then the next year we did a production that Neil Armfield directed of Twelfth Night, which was, again, wonderful. It was set on a Caribbean island, and so it was all calypso music and African music, and all us people with Australian accents. And Shakespeare works for those sort of characters, like characters like Bottom and the mechanicals in The Dream. And I played Toby Belch, who's a hopeless drunkard, and Jeffrey played Andrew Aguecheek, and we had the best time just being drunk all through the show. It was sensational.
Actually, drunk or drunk on stage?
Well, we were playing drunk. I wasn't drunk on stage, but we would ricochet around the theatre. We used to, there was a party in full swing when, a Caribbean party in full swing when the audience arrived in the theatre. And we used to go out into the foyer and mingle before the show, ricochet out and have a little drink with the, and it was fantastic. And by the time the audience got into the theatre, they'd had a few drinks and they were all fairly merry, and we were pretending to be sourced. And one of the funniest things was Leslie said to me, when I approached her in the foyer, she thought I was her father. She thought I'd been channeling her father, which had not occurred to me at all. But with hindsight, I suppose there was a bit of Tom in there. But it was a great production. Anyway, long story short, we took a couple of shows to Sydney. Twelfth Night was one of them, and we took a Patrick White play that he'd written especially for us called Netherwood, and all of a sudden people in Sydney remembered that I was alive, and I started getting all these offers, including as Alan Bond in the Challenge, and Menzies in The Last Bastion, and and eventually Rafferty's Rules, which you know, like there was a, I don't want to bore you with it, but you know, like I was asked if I'd auditioned for it, and I'd already accepted to play Menzies in The Last Bastion. And, you know, once, as you know, once you make a commitment to a show, you've got to do it. You know, you can't say, oh, I've had a better offer, I'm going to go, I'm pissing off. You know, you don't do that. It's not...
Well, some people do.
Well, it's not the right thing to do, and I wouldn't do it. And so I went off and did The Last Bastion, and they made a pilot of the show with Chris Haywood as Rafferty, a guy named Mark Little, who was a very well-known comic at the time and has since gone to the UK and had massive success on the radio over there. But they couldn't cut it together. Ben Lewin directed it, and he had written it, and they couldn't edit it for some reason, and so they had to reshoot. They decided it was still, you know, it was a good show, and they wanted to go on with it, and they wanted to reshoot it, and Chris wasn't available. And I'd just finished shooting The Last Bastion, so I was available now, and so I auditioned now, as I hadn't previously. I auditioned this time, but probably every other actor my age auditioned for it as well. I know that Graham Blundell auditioned. I don't know who else, but, you know, I imagine, you know, given the way the industry works, I reckon every actor my age and Graham's age at the time would have wanted to do the role. It was an amazing character.
I always thought Rafferty's Rules was a bit of a, I think Sea Change was a bit of a reverse cheat on Rafferty's Rules, because Rafferty's Rules was about a country magistrate who comes to the city, and Sea Change was of a city magistrate that goes to the country.
That's right, yes. I mean, and a lot, not a lot of people noticed it, but I certainly did.
How many years were you playing Rafferty? And it was difficult because you're away from your family, because it was all shot in Sydney, and you found that rather difficult, didn't you?
Well, it was immensely difficult. It was, you know, like I accepted the job, and I didn't expect it to go on as it did for about 5 years. And when we knew that it was going to go on, I wanted Leslie to come to Sydney with the kids, because we'd done it going to Adelaide, and that had worked. But it was a slightly different time, and Meg was about to start secondary school, and so Leslie thought it was not a good idea to bring them to Sydney, which was a pity. You know, it's no way to maintain a marriage or a family to spend that amount of time away from them. It's, that's something I would think twice about.
Now. Did you come to love the craft of television doing Rafferty, or had you already been swayed by then? Because it was that Fuller, it was your show, and it was, you know, you did like 100 and over, how many episodes of, sorry, it was
over 100, about 110, 100. I think. I'm not really sure, but it was something like that. It was, you know, like we got, it was done, and we did 6 episodes, and then we did 7 episodes to make it up to 13, to make it up to a series. And then it was done in a real piecemeal way. But then suddenly in 1988, I think, they said, okay, we're going to make 36 episodes. Are you on board? And I thought, 36 episodes, it's, you know, that's a long time. And that's, you know, like, and I thought, okay, yeah, okay, it's a year's work, and it's, you know, and it's good money, and it gave us the opportunity to buy this place, which I don't think we would have had the courage to commit to without that buffer of the job for 36 episodes. So, you know, it was never intended to be, you know, it was always just done in a piecemeal way. They didn't really make a commitment to it until that 36 eps. And funnily enough, I thought...
It was an unusual show, Rafferty's, John. It was an unusual show in that it was very, you describe it as almost like an ABC sort of style show, because it was very wordy. It was very legal, of course. It was very well written, and it had a really interesting array of really good Australian theatre actors doing very interesting parts, often bit parts. And but it certainly is the sort of TV that they simply don't make anymore, and haven't actually for a very long time.
No, I think, look, there's a bit of interest in getting it happening again. I've always been of the view that you could take those original scripts and just recast it and, you know, redo it with a slightly modern slant, and it would work again. I have a young actor friend who's trying to get it happening again.
Right.
And hoping that I'll be in it. But I'm far too old to be a magistrate or a policeman anymore. I was too old to be a policeman by the time they finally retired Blue Heelers. I was well and truly past police sergeant retiring age. And now, if I revived either of those shows, I'd have to be a hotelier or something.
You talk about bit parts in television and how often kind of, well, you didn't quite use the word soul destroying, but it came close to that. I love this quote from the book, if I can read it, about, I think, more writing is the chapter. Two or three lines as a petty crim in Cop Shop, subsequently arrested by John Osric and thrown into prison, wasn't really why I became an actor. Fame had never been on the agenda, but I thought I'd be commenting on my society in some small way. True, I didn't have to be very good or even do any real work, just say the lines and get arrested. But sometimes there were truly awful lines, such as that line, remember it?
You think I did it?
I had been made to deliver. It was to be remembered. I was to be remembered for this. As far as most audiences were concerned, the actor probably made those lines up anyway, even if the show gave so-and-so a writer's credit. They'd never mentioned the writer's name. No one had a clue who wrote such dialogue. Therefore, for several years, I became a television writer of no note. You're being very modest. You actually wrote hours and hours of Australian television, and you talk about that wonderful experience you had of being somewhere in a fish and chip shop somewhere, and there's an episode of Prisoner on the telly above your head, and you recognise the lines because you wrote them, and you look up and, oh, I wrote those.
Yeah, I know. That was I was with Frank Gallagher, and we were down in Lawn shooting a kid's show about a pony. And we were in the fish and chip shop, and I just heard these lines. I didn't realise the show was on, and standing waiting for our order, and I heard these lines, and I looked up and it was Prisoner. And, you know, like, but I recognised the lines because I wrote them. But I've never seen any of my stuff live to air. I don't know how
chip shop in Lawn.
It seemed to work okay. So.
We actually don't have much time left, John. We've only just scratched the surface of your very interesting and long career and interesting life. But we do have to judge just a little bit about Blue Heelers. Did Rafferty's lead directly into Blue Heelers? I mean, you had played a judge and then you were playing a cop. So there was a bit of contention around some of the network executives about letting that go through, was there not, in the beginning?
Yes, there was. I mean, I was, you know, I auditioned, and I thought, you know, when I read it, I thought Tony Morfitt wrote the pilot, and I'd known Tony on and off for many years from various shows that I'd done in Sydney with him, and he was the go-to writer, really, of the of for my whole life. But I thought, God, Tony's written this for me, because the character's name is Tom Croydon. I grew up in Croydon, you know, like it has to be for me. And my father-in-law's name's Tom. My grandfather's name was Tom. And I found out that my father's name was actually Tom. He called himself Les, but he was actually christened Thomas Leslie. So I thought, this has got to be written especially for me. And, you know, there seemed to be things about, you know, within the things that I read that sort of sat very well with the sort of personality that I was at the time. And the head programmer at Channel 7, a guy named Glenn Kinging, who had, you know, quite a reputation for, because programming, of course, you know, programmers go up against each other, you know, the Channel 9 guy and the Channel 7 guy would happily kill each other, you know, and they schedule shows, you know, everybody says, why do they always schedule the good shows up against each other? It's because they want to win the advertising battles.
Right.
And some shows that are really deserve to have huge audiences get nothing because something has already won that time slot and the show just disappears, which is a real tragedy in a sense. You know, we don't do enough good television to be able to afford to just chuck it away. And anyway, Glenn Kinging was of the view that the audience wouldn't believe me as a police sergeant because they would think of me as a magistrate. And I thought, well, it's, you know, whatever I do, I'm just acting, you know, I'm not a real person, or I wasn't a real magistrate, you know.
Well, occasionally, as some people have thought you were a real cop, there's a wonderful story you give of a couple of times you were mistaken for a real cop, going up into Russell Street and some crim coming in and looking over and, that was with Rafferty perhaps, but...
I wish you were my fucking magistrate.
Some guy being led away in handcuffs. We're really out of time, John. And look, we can probably leave talking about Blue Heelers because that's what people know. It's been great to hear about the earlier parts of your career and your life. But just in writing the book, when you come to write a book like this, how many, having met so many people and having worked with so many people, when you come to write your autobiography, did you feel obligated that you had to put everybody in and say nice things about them?
I didn't feel obligated to say nice things, but I felt obligated to put everybody in, and of course I didn't manage it, you know, like there's lots of people that I didn't mention. I don't know that I mentioned you, but anyway,
that'll be the next volume.
The thing that really interested me about the process was that I found it very similar to being working as an actor. I found myself being in the moment, as it were, you know, like being in the moment of remembering, you know, when I'd remember stuff about mum and dad, or, you know, I could actually picture myself there at the time and, you know, remember all the details of it. And, you know, what's hard is to edit in such a way that it's interesting, because I mean, I tend to go on and on and on, you know, and you know, so editing, it's the hard part. People, you know, like, yeah, really fascinating people. And
you know, I'm amazed you can remember all their names. I think that alone is impressive, that you remembered all their names. And I was being slightly facetious before, because you don't feel obliged to say nice things about everyone, and some people don't get nice things. David Leckie, who I don't think anybody has ever said a nice thing about ever, and it's no exception with you. He is, you remember him as the tyrant that everybody else seems to, in the industry, seems to remember him as.
Yes, I was just, I mean, I just found him, it was just disappointing, you know, like that he was such a bully. And, you know, like, I guess it's the difference between being an executive and being a performer or part of the team actually making the show. And, you know, like, and for theatre and television and film, everything depends on the well-being of the collective.
Yes.
You know, like, and the fact that everybody is prepared to share the moment. You know, like, it just doesn't happen if you don't work as a team. You know, it's very easy to be, you know, I am great, Michael, I can do this and I'll do blah, blah, blah. And if everybody else feels like shit, then that's what it's going to feel like in the end. You know, it's going to feel like shit. You have to be prepared to allow other people to contribute and be part of it. And, you know, and as I said, you know, it's a team effort, you know, and particularly on television, you know, nothing works without a cameraman being there, getting the right shot at the right time, or with the sound recorders, with the boom swinger not getting the right, you know, moment of sound. And, you know, if the wrong close-up comes at the wrong time, it's, you know, so you all have to work together. And I just found it really, I found it quite distressing that he was so unprepared to be part of the team. He was the boss, and he was the, you know, he was the be all and end all, and you know, like, that's the height of bad acting, in my view.
It's lovely though that on the flip side of that, some of your most fulsome praise, and it's so nice you end the book talking about your mate David Williamson, who we know from this year's Yarra Valley Writers Festival is a gentleman and a lovely man to whom no one can hold a candle, and you tend to agree, and also an incredibly important voice in Australian theatre, and whose words you have spent a big chunk of your career expressing that kind of modern Australian voice. And it's really glad that to read what you have to say about David in the book, John.
Well, you know, he's been the most influential writer we've ever had, without question. And, you know, like, his work's not that easy to do all the time, you know, like, he comes across as a very naturalistic writer, and everybody says, oh, you know, David writes such naturalistic dialogue, but in fact it's quite difficult, you know. It's not, he doesn't write the way people talk, you know. It's actually stylized in a way. It comes across as perfect naturalism, but it's stylized and not naturalistic at all. But he's he works at it. You know, like, he has, you know, if there's an issue that he takes issue with, he really gets stuck into it. And that play, that last play, you know, it was such a, you know, like, it's a sister, about a sister dying, and legalized a sister dying, and it seems to be a non-issue in Australia at the moment, because it's been legalized in most states, except, funnily enough, New South Wales, which is where the play was set and where we did it. And I don't know how it would work in all the other states these days. You know, there's
Crunch Time. We should say the name of the play. Crunch Time's the name of the play, isn't it?
Yes, Crunch Time, yes. And it's, you know, it's, and it's a really tough play, and a play that's sort of about tough love. You know, the father, you know, the father who finds out he's dying, really loves his wife, and he loves his two sons, and he's quite fond of his daughters-in-law, although I think he sees them as money grabbers. But it's tough love, you know. The father wants the boys or the wife to help him with that final injection. And it was quite chilling to do, you know. Like, I remember the first day we actually did it, the first time we actually did the death scene in the rehearsal room, it was... Because I, you know, like, one of the things I try to do as an actor is live the moment, and to
or die the moment.
Dying is quite confronting, and in fact, I sort of came away from that rehearsal quite unnerved, and I don't know that I would actually be capable of it, of. Uh-huh. Giving myself the injection or of asking anybody else to give me the injection. You know, like, if I'm going to do it, I'd rather not know about it. You know, it's not a, it's a
well,
very...
Well, certainly giving a whole new... Situation. Certainly and, giving a whole new slant, dying on stage expression as well.
Sorry, say again?
A whole new slant to the dying on stage expression. I'm sure you made that joke in the rehearsal room a few times too.
Yeah.
John, we're out of time. Thank you so much for giving us so much of your time in this extended chat.
Pleasure. Great to talk
about,
to you.
Your autobiography. Will there be a volume two? Because I'm, as you mentioned, I'm not in it. So I reckon that's a volume two coming.
Yeah, there might have to be. I don't know if I've got that many words in me, but...
You'll have to dish the dirt, though, a little bit. John Woods, How I Clawed My Way to the Middle, on behalf of the Yarra Valley Writers Festival. Thank you so much. And of course, John, you are a Yarra Valley resident.
Yes,
yourself.
And I've been since 1988. Yeah.
Wonderful. Doubly, a double pleasure to have you. Next week, I will be back in the interviewer's hot seat talking to this fella, Jock Sarong, about an absolutely his second, or maybe his third, but it's a subsequent novel from his earlier work, which was called Preservation, about an adventure in the 1830s in the Bass Strait Islands. This follows from it. It is brilliant. Jock Sarong's The Burning Island. I can't wait to talk to him. See you next time. John Wood, thank you so much.
Thanks.